Church. So thankful that you're here with us today. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we're going to do what? We're going to rejoice. We're going to be glad in it. Church, let's stand together this morning as we sing a song that speaks about our awesome God. We want to worship Him in wonder and in majesty. Let's worship. Let's praise today, church.
Strong.
Jesus, church. Right. Souls, we're looking for souls to be saved, revived. He's so awesome. Have your way, Holy Spirit, as we let go and let you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. Hey guys, God's Mighty Men is coming up Saturday, September 17th. So in place of our men's breakfast for this month, we're going together to God's Mighty Men. Hope to see you there as we learn to worship God and come together as men. It's going to be from 8:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. on that Saturday, so we hope you'll come join us for a great time. Tickets, you can talk to Lester or go to godsmightymen.com to find out more information.
On October 30th, from 3 to 5, we're going to combine our trunk retreat out from Shining Lights Church with Cross Point's Fall Harvest Festival, and it's going to be amazing. Trunk retreat is where you decorate a trunk, and if you are a crafted nerd like me, find some old things to do, like this is from Bible Adventure Camp. I'm going to decorate my trunk that way. And then grab some candy from the store so that when the kids come dressed up in their costumes, you'll have some candy to hand out to them. All right, remember, October 30th from 3 to 5. We'll see you then.
October 24th, it's a Saturday, we're going to be having an all-church work day at the Cross Point facility on Forest Drive. We're going to be meeting from 9 till noon, and we've got a number of tasks, particularly in the range of weeding and raking and pruning a lot of our outdoor areas. We also want to invite you to come as we're going to be having a lunch together from noon till 1:30 as we celebrate the great time we've had working and fellowshipping together. On the 24th, from 1:30 to 2:30, we're going to have a time of prayer walking the neighborhoods around the church. This is a great opportunity for us to come together as the body of Christ and go out praying over the people, the homes, the neighborhoods, and praying for God's vision to reach the lost and the hurting in the Mountain View Park neighborhood area. So we hope you'll come and join us on the 24th. Come to work, stay for lunch, and enjoy a great time of fellowship and prayer afterwards. What would you say is a challenge in marriage? What would you say is a joy of being married?
First off, a clarification, our church work day is not October 24th, it's September 24th in 2 weeks. So I would be doing an awful lot of work all by myself, so please come on September 24th in 2 weeks so that I don't have to do anything on my own. Because my wife will tell you, when I'm on my own, I get kind of carried away, and all of a sudden walls disappear and things like that happen, and the project gets a lot bigger, so somebody needs to be there to keep me in check, at the very least. So September 24th for that. Also, the marriage retreat is coming up. We need you to get registered for that in the next week by the 18th. Church, marriage is such an important thing. I mean, you don't get past one chapter into Scripture, and we already see God's design for marriage. And yet we see all over the place how Satan attacks marriages in our world today, and how many people in the world, marriage is virtually meaningless. You come together, you get married for as long as it's good, and then you divorce and you move on. And the reality is that the church isn't much different than that. God, we've been called to honor God through marriage, through families. And church, we want to come together. We want to provide a place, this Art of Marriage Retreat. It's October 21 to 23 at the Homewood Suites in Fort Collins is where we're going to be. We want to offer a time to get away for a little bit and enjoy some time with your spouse, as well as with a bunch of other people from the church, really focusing on your marriage. And I know the costs get to be a little bit much at times, especially with the way everything else in this world is going. But I want to encourage you to invest in your marriage. If money is still an issue, I've had some people come to me and say they will scholarship people to go. If money is an issue, please come and talk to me, and we will see what we can do to get that taken care of. We want you to go. If you've got a couple of kids and you're like, well, I can't go, we've got these kids. I've also had people come and say they'll take kids for the weekend as well.
Woo-hoo.
There you go. All right, all right. So, you're on the hook now, right? So we want you to come and enjoy this time and have a great time as a couple and just with our body of believers for that weekend as we grow together. Investing in marriage is such an important thing. Now we get to see Marlon and Becky there at almost 50 years of marriage. And I know sometimes it's easy to look at situations like that and just say, well, yeah, they've got it a whole lot better than I do, than we do. Things are so much easier. I'm going to guarantee you that's not the case.
Amen.
But they made a choice about how they were going to work on their marriage and invest in it. And so I want to invite you to this opportunity to invest in your marriage at this marriage retreat. We're going to have Robert and Ann Coletti from Family Life Ministries coming to lead us for the weekend, and it's going to be a great time. So there's information out in the Welcome Center. You can go online at shinealliance.church and find out more information about the marriage retreat as well, or you can come up and talk to me, and especially if you have any questions about needing financing or childcare or whatever, come talk to me. Let's figure it out so that you can go and invest in your marriage on that weekend. Also, as a church, as we are continuing to come together, we've been looking at some different name ideas as a church and who God is calling us to be, and names that are going to really depict the vision and the mission that God has for us. And so in the next couple of weeks, we're going to be revealing some names to the church. But with that, we want your participation in that. If you've got a name that God is speaking to you for the church and you think would be really picture, show what God is doing here, what his mission for us is, talk to your pastors, your elders, your leadership council. Let us know what those thoughts are so that we can pool all of those ideas. And then we are going to bring a few of those ideas to the congregation in a few weeks to start to mull those over and look at how these names are really representing the mission that God has for us. And then we'll be picking a name from there as we continue on with, as we transition into being one church from the two churches. And so we're very excited about that. Lastly, that I have for you this morning, on the back table by the media booth, or if you're in the upper room worshiping back by the doors where you came in, there's a table there with a couple of cards. And one of them is for your prayer requests, because we love praying for you. We want to know specifically what are the things that we can be bringing before the throne of heaven on your behalf. And there's another card there that says, welcome. If you're visiting with us, we want to be able to connect with you and let you know about the different ministry opportunities and times and things like that, or things that are going on. And so please grab one of those and fill that out so that we can connect with you. And there's a box on that table. Place for those cards as well as your tithes and offerings this morning. So with that, let's stop again here as we continue to pray and just lift this morning up to Jesus. Father, we love you. We worship you this morning. Even as we sang this morning, Jesus, we praise you that you are the way maker. You are the miracle worker. You are the promise keeper.
Hallelujah.
Lord, even when it feels like we can't do it on our own, that is who you are.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
We have confidence in you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Father, as we look at moving to the back to the Forest Drive facility, as we come together in that place, as we work there, as we have our trunk or treat there, all these things coming together, Lord, we pray for your blessing on that. We pray that you would move in the hearts of people in that neighborhood to seek you. We pray that as we go around and praying over those neighborhoods, that you would speak your vision to our hearts to reach people there with your love, with your gospel. Father, we pray that your spirit would be turning hearts already to respond as we act in obedience and follow you. Jesus, in all these other things that we have coming up in the next few weeks, in the next couple of months, Lord, would it all be for your glory. Jesus, we want to see you high and lifted up. We want to see you glorified. We want to see you worshiped. Would you lead us in that direction? We love you. We praise you, Jesus. In your name, amen. Well, right now I want to invite Marlon Casey up to share with us about some things to be praying about and thinking about in missions.
Point of honest confession, Becky wasn't teasing when she pointed at me doing it. I'm still learning. I heard that. Hey, on mission updates, there's two parts we're going to talk about. The first one is a couple that's part of our district of people that are sent out as international workers. And that's David and Bethany Thomas. They are getting ready to go to Bangkok. They'll be working with Envision there. And they have 2 months before they go. And they also are asking for prayer because they have 4 months of work to do in 2 months. And that's a challenge. One of the big concerns they have is leaving kids behind. And as a parent, that gets tough. It gets difficult. And so they have a couple of prayer requests in that area. Andrew, their son, is starting college. They're looking for ways. They want that to be an easy transition from being a home school to being in college in a different life. And then for Carly, who is their daughter, she is going to be searching for affordable housing when they leave. And if it's anything like here, affordable housing is an oxymoron. And so pray for that. And then also, Bethany and David will be sorting, selling, packing up belongings as they move closer to their final days in Kalispell. The next area we're going to talk about is our trunk or treat. Because missions does not happen just overseas. It does not happen in another city only. It happens here in Cheyenne. This is our opportunity to do that. And we have a community that we want to reach out to. We want them to know who we are, where we're at, and how in the world can we find them and help them. So, having your vehicle decorated up, or the trunk, or however you want to do it, is more than just passing out candy. You have no way of knowing, neither do I, of what those kids face, what situations, what hopes are being represented. That is what we need to discover. That is what we need to pray for. Those are the ones that we need to love, because it makes a difference. My first challenge to you is, kids come, either prior or during, please pray for them. Some of the homes are in a mess. They look good on the outside, but they're a mess. And kids need loving, and by the way, so do their parents. There is a song that's new that's out. It is written from the viewpoint of a person who is outside the church, looking in and begging for help. And I'm going to read just a portion of the lyrics. And really, I hope and pray it touches you. It kind of slapped me along the face in defining our need, but it's a person crying out for help, and it goes like, and the name of the song is I'm Still Out There by Casting Crowns. It goes like this, but I'm still out here. I may be hiding, but I'm still hoping to be found here. I'm still out here. I have been waiting for someone to listen past the words my hurt is saying. Tell me I'm worth saving, and that I'm still worth fighting for. I'm still out here. The skeptic with questions, now shut me down and I'll have the last word. But I wouldn't mind if you stuck around. You see, my questions, my fortress, they guard my broken heart. Maybe you've got an answer that can break my walls apart, because I'm still out here. I may be hiding, but I'm still hoping. to be found here. I'm still out here. I've been waiting for someone to listen. Past words by her to say, tell me that I'm worth saving and I'm still worth fighting for. We're not the villain. We're not the enemy. We're just broken people wandering through the dark. That's all we are. Loving us is going to cost you. So are you willing to be the light you say you are? I hope you are. The cost of not doing anything far exceeds any minor cost that you or I have in decorating a vehicle or buying candy and passing it out, or the time in that. It is going to cost us to build relationships. We must. I guess that's the nicest way of saying it. It's something that we must. There is a table right out here with clipboards on it. If you have interest, put your name there. I dare you to, or ask questions. Julie, Patty, or the people that are organizing it, talk to them. Any of the pastoral staff, allow me to encourage you. It's worth it. So now for the Thomases and our, boy, I tell you, my brain just went blank. That thing, trunk or treat, thank you. Pastor Kevin, would you come and please pray for us on that? Thank you.
Thanks, Marlon. Appreciate you sharing that. What I would like for you to do with me today is I would like for you to pray over our missionaries, the international workers, David and Bethany, as they get ready to go. Marlon shared with us some prayer requests about the workload that they have as they get ready to go, their family transition. And so I'm just going to invite you to cluster with those who are around you. And if one person would just lead out in prayer, for David and Bethany and their family. Appreciate that just for like a minute, and then I'll close this in prayer. So would you stand with me and cluster with those around you? And if one person would just lead out in prayer for David and Bethany, we'd appreciate it. Father, we thank you for just the opportunity to lift David and Bethany to you and their family. God, we pray for your incredible blessing upon them as they get ready to go to Bangkok. And so, God, we just pray that you prepare the way. We also pray over the trunk or treat event that we are planning, Lord. We want you to be in the middle of that. We ask that your spirit would begin now to prepare hearts that come that day, that we will connect with children and families to share the gospel message, the hope that you have placed into our lives, where we want to share that with others. And where that is a big part of what we are trying to do as a mission is to get that out there. And so, Lord, prepare us. May your spirit work in us that we will have a great opportunity to reach that Mountain View Park neighborhood and all of Cheyenne with the gospel message. Lord, as we prepare, pray for your blessing upon that. In Jesus' name.
We're going to continue in worship this morning, church. And we sing a song, Jesus, I Sing All That You've Done For Me. We were talking about earlier in the, when we were warming up the praise team, but if we were to truly do that, if we were to come up and sing for all that the Lord has done for us, we'd be up here a really, really long time.
Amen.
And Sometimes words fall short. We want to express our gratitude and our love for the Lord. And so, church, we're going to continue in worship. And you can stand, you can sit, kneel, raise your hands, pray, sing as you feel led. Just contemplate how we want to worship our Lord through all that He's done for us. Give Him all the praise and glory that's due His name.
I've got together in unity. Reconciliation, it's not about us. It's all about you. Lord, we just thank you. We praise you for the work that you're doing in our lives individually, in our lives corporately as a church. As you work in us, through us, may you be glorified and honored. Holy Spirit, come and fill us this morning and guide us in your truth. Knowledge of you, that we may know you better. Lord, that we may have a closer relationship with you. May walk with you as you mold us and make us more like you, to honor and glorify you. As you make us fulfilled in your idea of what we should be, which we will, as you are working in us. And Lord, we just praise you and thank you. And we don't have anything except for what we are and who we are right here. And we just offer it all up to you. Come, be glorified in my life. Use me as you will. Your glory and your purpose. May I be a light for you as you shine through me, that others may know you. We pray these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Be seated. What a blessing to be together in God's house with God's family, singing praises to our Lord, offering prayers and offerings, and hearing God's word proclaimed. It really is a beautiful thing that we get to do each and every Sunday together as a family, as a body of believers. Well, this morning, I would like you to just take a moment, and I want you to think back to 1 year ago. Think back to 1 year ago, September 2021. What were your plans for 2022? What were you hoping God would do? A year ago, and now here we are today. What were the things that you were thinking would happen? What plans were you making? What did you think this year was going to bring? I can tell you right now, I had no idea what the Lord had in store for me in this church 1 year ago.
Amen.
This year has been a wild ride, to say the very least. Last September, if you would have told me that in 1 year's time, we would have worked through a church merger with all of the different components that entailed, and now we would be walking through all of the hard work of transitioning a new church in a new direction, I would have simply laughed and said, absolutely not. But as we've said so many times over the years, none of these kinds of things catch God by surprise.
Amen.
He has known about this since before the foundation of the earth was even spoken into existence. Just think on that for a while. That's mind-boggling to consider.
Amen.
But this is a good perspective to keep in mind for anything that might be going on in your life right now. God is in control, and he always gives us what we need exactly when we need it. Let me say this one more time. God is in control, and he always gives us exactly what we need when we need it. That is a 100% money-back guaranteed true statement, and it should give you comfort both in the present and as you consider the future. With all of that said, I want to just take a few moments by way of starting today and speak about where we have been as a church and where we are going as a church. Now, my intention is not to turn this into a business meeting. I just simply want to provide a quick recap of where we have been as a church over the past 10 months or so. And it has been, again, a wild ride to say the least.
Amen.
12 months ago, September 2021, I am guessing that there is not a person in this room who could have articulated where we would be at it as a church today. We all had thoughts, we all had ideas, but God had a completely different plan.
Amen.
About the end of November or so, 2021, the pastoral staffs and the leadership teams of both Cheyenne Alliance Church and Cross Point Fellowship, we began discussing the possibility of these two churches coming together as one new church, continuing under the Christian and Missionary Alliance. Meetings and long, hard discussions took place.
And it was determined to continue walking down this road, bringing the possibilities eventually to both congregations earlier this year. Again, after much discussion as two congregations and seeking the Lord, if you remember, we voted and we officially approved both congregations to merge together. We did that on July 10th.
Amen.
And then the merger became official August 1st. And we began meeting as one new church here at the Alliance Building just a little over a month ago on August 7th. It's been just a little bit over a month since we've been meeting together. Now, as we know, this is not going to be our permanent residence. We will be moving over to the Cross Point Building, the Forest Drive facility, the South Campus, whatever you want to call it right now. We'll be moving over there in the near future, but not before September 30th, the end of this month. Over the past month or so, different transition teams, they've been meeting, they've been making decisions regarding the future, needed work that needs to be take place over at the other building and preparation for our moving over there. This is not an exhaustive list, but you may have noticed that the parking lot has been completely refinished and redone, along with other outdoor cleanup. Also, there's been some other things that aren't as noticeable. There's been some plumbing work, some electrical work that's been completed inside the building. There's more yet to be done. Decisions have been made concerning designation of certain rooms, other interior decisions such as putting chairs into the sanctuary. We're still working on collecting bids and estimates for other needed work that's yet to be done. But it's coming together. And you can keep up on all of these decisions by looking at the minutes that are posted on that bulletin board right outside the central office. After every meeting, we post a new set of minutes on the top, and you can look at those at any point in time to see what all is going on. Now lastly, as a pastoral staff and a leadership team, we have been praying, we've been discussing, we've been seeking the Lord about overall direction as a church. What is it that God is calling us to in the city of Cheyenne and into the world? What bridges are we needing to cross in order to fulfill the mission that God is calling us to? Church, these are exciting times. And I encourage all of us to be involved together through prayer and through fasting.
Amen.
Lift up the leadership. Pray for them regularly. As you have questions or as you have thoughts, feel free to contact any one of the pastoral staff or leaders and have a good conversation. Let me say this again. Call any of the leadership or pastoral staff and have a good conversation.
Amen.
Don't call us and ream us out about what you want or what you don't like about something. Have a good conversation.
Amen.
We need each other through this process.
Amen.
And I am confident that God is going to do tremendous things as we seek Him together. Now, with all of that said, I would just simply like to take a few minutes and talk about what we can look forward to and expect in the immediate future. Now, as I mentioned, we will not be moving over to the South facility, the Cross Point Building, before September 30th, that I can tell you. But our desire is to move over there as soon as possible after that. A firm date has yet to be determined. Once that date is decided upon, we will communicate that immediately so that everybody's aware, we can begin planning and preparation. We have come to the determination that some of the work that we hoped to have accomplished before moving over there will not be able to be accomplished in a timely enough manner. That's all right. It's all right. When I used to be a high school band director, I had on my door a big sign that says, "In the middle of adversity lies opportunity."
Amen.
I had two signs, actually, so the students would look at it whenever they walked in my office. In the middle of adversity lies opportunity. Notice, lack of planning on your part does not constitute an emergency on mine.
Right.
I had those two right there on my office. But in the middle of adversity lies opportunity, and we are going to have opportunity, church, to work around projects in a gracious manner, in a creative manner over the coming months. Let's view this as God-given opportunities to extend grace to each other. Some items that we are currently working on that need to be decided soon is the overall firm mission of the church and then a name change. And these two things are going to go together. We want the name of the church to reflect and speak exactly what it is that God has called us to as a church body in the city of Cheyenne and beyond. And this is something that's being worked on by the leadership teams. It will be brought to the congregation soon. Pastor Siebert talked about this in the announcement time. Also, we are working on final room designations. Where are certain ministries going to be located within the church? Even if they're not realized immediately because there's needed construction that has to take place. We move over there. Some ministries are housed somewhere temporarily while things are being done, but we know where the final destination is going to be. We are trying to get as much done in the sanctuary as quickly as possible before moving over there. And as decisions are made, they will be articulated again through the posted minutes, or decisions of more importance will be mentioned publicly as well. These are exciting times.
Amen.
And we are trusting the Lord to work powerfully in our midst to glorify His name, to further His kingdom right here in Cheyenne and to the world as we cross bridges together, so to speak, bringing the gospel of truth.
Amen.
So with all of that in mind now, I want to turn your attention to 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 12. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 12. Let me just read this passage to you. And there we hear this. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil.
Amen.
These verses that I just read to you, they are in a broader section of Peter's letter where he is talking about living in submission to one another. Peter, he begins verse 8 by saying, finally, this is Peter's summary statement about living in submission. He has addressed what it means in chapter 3 to live in submission to all authorities, whether the civil magistrate or vocational, your boss, or your teacher students, right? Living in submission to them. He's addressed what it means to live in submission within the marriage relationship. And now he wants to sum it all up, and he does so by giving five aspects that must be present in our lives and in our course of action. Understand that as we move forward as a church, this is the needed mindset that we must exhibit. And Peter starts by saying you need to have unity of mind. As we move forward, we need to have unity of mind. Unity of mind, it has the idea of living in harmony with one another. This is unity, not uniformity. In other words, it does not mean that every single one of us think exactly the same thing about everything.
Amen.
But we are together in one accord. Church, with all of these people and all the other people in the first service, we are not going to think exactly the same thing about everything. That is impossible. But we need to move together in one accord, working together for the common goal of spreading the gospel and having like-minded attitudes.
Amen.
This does not mean that we are carbon copies of one another. Each person in this church has been specially gifted by God with talents and personality and passions. And just like different notes are played together to make a chord which creates a beautiful harmony, so must the body of Christ come together to serve God and create a beautiful harmony as we move forward.
Amen.
Now, the next attitude that we see in the mindset, the needed mindset, is as we move forward, we need to have sympathy. Unity of mind, and we need to have sympathy. Now, understand, again, as we make decisions and we move forward, people are going to have different reactions. And that is all right.
Amen.
There's nothing wrong with that. We need to make space for that. as there are changes to perhaps long-held traditions. We've always done it this way as a church, and now you're telling me we're doing it this way. Or maybe places of comfort, things that made you comfortable, that made you feel good. Some people are going to grieve.
Yes.
And that is all right.
Amen.
We need to allow that grief process to take place, but we cannot stay there. We cannot hold on to the past. We need to move forward into the future. But as people are grieving, we need to have sympathetic hearts towards each other as brothers and sisters in Christ.
Amen.
And this, again, this has the idea of being empathetic, understanding how people are feeling, and then being responsive to their needs and feelings, having a sensitivity, having a compassion toward each other. We must understand and appreciate one another because of our mutual relationship as a body of Christ belonging to Jesus. And Peter then reminds us that we are to have brotherly love towards one another. Brotherly love towards one another. Church, understand that this must define us. In fact, I'm going to change that. Church, this will define us.
Yes.
It's not that it must. No, this will define who we are. Brotherly love, it's actually a translation of the Greek word in the text, philadelphos, which is one of the Greek words for love. That's where we get the name of the city, Philadelphia, actually. You know, the city of brotherly love, as they call it. I haven't been there for a long time. Whether it's living up to its name, I couldn't tell you. But this is one of the Greek words for love, and it has the idea of a love for one another based upon a mutual affection or a mutual association. We are all members of the same church. We are all members of one church. I've tried really hard, and I catch myself, and I just say it, you know, just knock it off. You can't do this anymore. Talking about Shine Alliance people, Crosspoint people, the Alliance building, the Crosspoint building, I try to get that out of my mouth.
Amen. Amen.
We are one church.
Yes.
A family that God has put together. We need to demonstrate a strong love for our fellow family members because of our same association with Jesus.
Amen.
We are one church under one name, Jesus. We must demonstrate that in the way that we love one another.
Amen.
We will demonstrate that in the way that we love one another.
Yes.
And not only do we need to extend brotherly love toward each other, but we must possess a tender heart. We have to have tender hearts, church. Again, this has the idea of being compassionate. But just like being sympathetic, we must be conscious of each other's needs, of each other's feelings, of each other's thoughts, and then do our best to meet those things in some way.
Amen.
We should be deeply touched, deeply moved by the hurts and the needs and the joys of fellow believers, and then step out and act on them to help them. As a church family, we should be affectionate. We should be sensitive toward each other and then act quickly to give emotional support where needed.
Amen.
The last trait that Peter mentions is that we all must possess a humble mind. We have to have humble minds. This has the idea of simply keeping an honest assessment of oneself before God. Now, it does not mean having a negative assessment of who you are. Self-deprecation and beating yourself up is not humility.
Amen.
It's not what I'm talking about. It's just simply keeping an honest view of your characteristics, your abilities, and how they can be used within the body of Christ, all the while thanking God for what he's done for you.
Amen.
It's his work anyways,
Amen.
Not ours. It also has the idea of putting other people first. This is Philippians 2, 3 and 4 in action. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each one of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Let's live lives of humility today, all to the glory of God. As we live out this mindset, as we put these principles and this mindset into action, it will manifest itself in the way spelled out in verses 10 and 11. Listen to those again. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. We will be a people. We will be a church that is known for positive and encouraging words.
Amen.
We will be a people who are known for peaceful actions. Our desire will be to bless other people instead of lashing out at them when things do not go the way that we wanted them to.
Amen.
Oh, how I pray that we have this mindset and that we will experience this as a church as we move forward in this transition, because the outcome is incredible. Listen to verse 12. When we do these things, for the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. We need to keep all of these things in mind as we continue on the path that the Lord has us on. We need to have this mindset moving forward. And we see that when we do, God's eyes will be on us.
Amen.
When we're living this out, God's eyes will be on us. What a comforting thought that the eyes of the Lord are on us.
Amen.
You know, I remember taking my children when they were little to play at the park. They were so excited, and they wanted to try everything out 100 times, and I'd be on the park equipment with them, playing around, doing all kinds of things, but then they want to do it by themselves, right?
Amen.
I'd let them, but I never took my eyes off them. I'd watch them the whole time. And some of these parks are big, you know, where'd they go? I made sure I knew exactly where they were at all times. I watched over them, ready to step in, protect them if necessary, bail them out. You know, just this past summer, we went to Missoula to help my mother-in-law. We cleaned out her house because we had to relocate her. And Isaac and Cass and Ezra, they came over from where they live. And I got to do the same thing with my grandson Ezra. Watched him on the park, but I never took my eyes off him. And you know what? Soon, with my granddaughter Eliana, I'll be doing the same thing. She's going to be running around sooner than I can imagine.
Yep. Amen.
The bottom line is this. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous.
Amen.
And when we are moving forward with the right mindset, we are living righteous lives. This is where we need to be, both individually and corporately as a church.
Amen.
The other thing that we see is that God's ears are open to the prayers of the righteous. When we are moving forward with this mindset, God will hear our prayers. God will hear our prayers when we have this mindset. Now, I don't know about you, but I have been praying an awful lot over the last 10 months or so. This is not to say that I didn't pray before,
Amen.
But my prayer time has certainly increased, and with fervency and frequency as we've begun this merger and now transition. I want what God wants.
Amen.
And the best way to determine that is to spend time in conversation with the Lord. Also, I need His strength. I need His wisdom. I need direction more than ever, because truth is, church, I've never done this before.
Amen.
I've never done this. And my guess is nobody in here has done this before either. We're on new turf.
Amen.
We're moving in a new direction. We need the Lord more than ever because we don't know what we're doing.
Amen.
We have begun an incredible journey together, and we need the Lord to lead us and guide us through it. There are going to be challenging times as we walk this journey. And we are going to cry out to the Lord in earnest prayer. Boy, I hope His ears are open to those prayers.
Amen.
Perhaps you're praying, Lord, I am struggling with some of the changes that are going on. Please give me Your heart regarding this change. Or perhaps you are in leadership and you're asking the Lord to grant you wisdom regarding decisions that need to be made. Also, I certainly hope that all of us are praying regularly for the church, for its leadership, for each other. In all of these prayers, I desire God to hear and move on our behalf. And this will happen as we move forward with the proper mindset, putting into practice all of the characteristics that we have mentioned. When all this comes together, the church, it will.
Amen.
It's going to come together.
Amen.
People are going to be amazed at who Jesus is, how he works in the life of his children and his church. This is what Cheyenne needs to see. Cheyenne does not to see yet one more church fighting and dividing. They need to see the gospel at work in the lives of ordinary people who are empowered by an extraordinary God. As we develop all of these characteristics in our lives and in our corporate body, we will be able to see and live lives of godly submission with the proper mindset and then be a good witness to what Jesus can do in a person individually and in a church corporately.
Amen.
We are a people set apart. And as we live as such people, others are going to notice. They will be drawn to the Lord because of it. Church, let's move and let's have the proper mindset as we move forward together, crossing over bridges as one church, bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ to the city of Cheyenne and to the world. Let's pray. Father, we give you praise and thanks for what you're doing in this church. What you're doing in our hearts and our minds as you're doing what you're doing in this church. Lord, these are exciting times. They're hard times. They're challenging times. They're good times. And through it all, you are building your church, and the gates of hell will not stand against it. We can cross over the bridge into the city of Cheyenne to the world beyond, bringing the gospel message not only in word, but also in deed, because people are going to see what you are doing. And their lives are going to be changed because of it. And so we say thank you in advance to all that you do. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to close with one last song here today, and it really is sort of a prayer. We're going to musically pray over each other this morning. Again, as we consider all of the things that God is doing, We need him in powerful ways. And so, church, let's stand together. And we are going to musically pray over one another this morning as we continue to seek God together. Let's close in that.
Your feet from stumbling, I
will be changed.